Thanks for listening in, everyone. My name is Kate Ladenheim. I'm the artistic director of a dance company called the People Movers, and I'm also the artist in residence at the Robotics, Automation, and Dance, or RAD Lab, at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. Today I'm presenting the paper, Live Dance Performance Investigating the Feminine Cyborg Metaphor with a Motion-Activated Wearable Robot. The piece we built is titled Babyface and is an artistic work taking the form of a machine-augmented solo responding to feminized tropes around innocence, servitude, cuteness, and spectacle. I was asked to join the Rad Lab as an artist in residence shortly after I saw an exhibit called Heavenly Bodies at the Met Museum in New York City, and that provided the first seed of inspiration for this work. This exhibit featured religiously inspired garments, which were almost exclusively made for feminine bodies. And as I walked through this exhibit, I saw dresses that were so fluffy that no one could possibly move inside them, and these large wooden wings attached to rigid corsets. And these garments all walked this fine line between aesthetic awesomeness and physical limitation. This is also a presentation that I see play out in many artificial systems. So for example, here we have Instagram performances like Lil Miquela, video game characters like Mercy and Overwatch, chatbots like Mitsuku, and robots like Misty, who all have these kind of hyperbolic, performatively feminine characteristics. And they're impressive pieces of technology, but they're also stereotypical and limited. Our work shares a similar point of view with Donna Haraway in her seminal text, The Cyborg Manifesto, where she states, "The cyborg is a kind of disassembled and reassembled postmodern collective and personal self. This is the self feminists must code. The act of being forced to move as machines require serves as a physicalized form of patriarchy. This can be empowering if we are able to take control of it. But more often, the feminine ideal that most robots code tracks closely with tradition. We see this in performances from Sophia the Robot, here as a classically feminine Instagram influencer, Pepper from SoftBank Robotics, who looks very innocent and curvy, and in disembodied systems like the voice of Alexa, Siri, and Cortana. From these influences, a story about a cyborg who's designed to look and perform within this narrow archetype emerged. Tools are a big part of storytelling as they tell, record, and comprise the plots of stories. When we reflect on early tools, for example, hammers, wedges, spikes, and things like that, we see straightforward objects that advertise their function intuitively through visible form. Therefore, a knife that threatens to kill an innocent protagonist is apparent in these previous stories. However, as the inner workings of machines have grown more complex, so too has the reverence we assign them, and this can create something of a spectacle. As soon as a woman stands on stage next to a robot, her body stands in reference as an opposite association to these machines, which are typically crafted, created, and celebrated by men. And both the machine and her body in this case become a spectacle. And this can limit the stories she can tell and the tools at her disposal to do so. In our case, the tools we use to tell this story are a pair of wings. This machine is an expressive tool that demands this sort of reverence and alternate gender association in order to tell the story of feminine grandeur and the burden performing it creates. We built two separate wings which are actuated by a servo motor on each side, and this spreads or retracts the wings in a planar bar linkage system. You'll notice that the wings are disconnected, and this allows the performer to manipulate their motion from her shoulder blades. While the coded motion is restricted to one plane, the performer can send the wings in and outside of this plane, and this reaction becomes highly dramatized in juxtaposition. Our design constrained motion to the coronal plane. This is the plane where we pose for photographs. The wings frame the body in this flattened place, which references presentational settings in screen-based media. You can think about things like Instagram or stages. This supports choreography that is posed, linear, and front-facing, and this physical arrangement of the body also serves as a metaphor for the flattening of a character. It limits the perception of depth in the body and the surrounding space, and alludes to the limited view of women in relation to machines. Our design process greatly informed the choreography and vice versa. We wanted to build a channel of intent between the device and the performer, so rather than displaying a robot or a human on stage, we wanted to build the illusion that the two were intertwined. Lights in this system really support this illusion. They provide dynamically unconstrained degrees of freedom. These can respond quite rapidly to the performer's motion. In our case, the lights change colors and move in a chase pattern when the performer bends side to side or moves her hips. and this underscores a sense of liveness and simultaneity in the performance. Mechanical and electrical elements come together and are attached to the performer through a costume. The costume was made from transparent vinyl and holographic faux leather. These materials allow audiences to see the electronic components and also accentuate the futuristic design of the costume and the cultural constraints of the display. And now I'll talk you through some video excerpts of the piece so that you can get a sense of how all of these elements come together. First, the dancer emerges out of the darkness and her wings unfold. And then there's a dramatic shift in mood from darkened, introspective to cutesy fun times. You see the side-to-side hip motion in the coronal plane and these repetitive, hyper-feminized hand and face gestures. Then the cyborg moves into a moment of malfunction. The wings come in and out of the coronal plane here and accentuate this chaos.
Don't worry. If you're nice to me, I'll be nice to you.
Finally, the performer resumes dancing with a more fluid quality, and she passes through iconographic poses and gestures with a voiceover of a digitized, hyper-feminized character. And then the piece ends in a dark and downtrodden place. Informal audience feedback revealed associations to existing artworks featuring robots, primarily popular films and television like Her and Black Mirror, Westworld, and Ex Machina. The audience also had questions about spectacle control and functionality. Primarily, they were questioning if the human or the machine was in control. And they attached both functional and emotional associations to robotic motion. So when the performer was moving in smooth, integrated motions, it was seen as elegant, beautiful, and inspiring, especially when those were performed with smooth, graceful motions from the wings. And then jagged, sporadic motion from both the wings and the performer were seen as alarming or an indicator that the performer was breaking down or somehow in pain. The performer's experience also happens to be my own, as I'm the one who's dancing in this video and in many of these photographs. And a few of the sensations that I experienced were physical. So there's this kind of interplay between limitation and augmentation. I felt wider and more expressive, and I had this whole other limb to work with, but also the wings limited the actual motion of my body. So my upper spine, chest, and back in particular had to be held in a certain way, and so it encouraged choreography to move more distally towards my legs and my arms. There is also haptic feedback from the wing system, which includes vibration from the servo's activation and the sound of the motors and attachments. And the weight of the wings as it's distributed in my body changes as they expand and contract. These physical sensations alluded to the complicated relationship between adoration of cuteness, femininity, and service, and the limitation that this adoration presents for feminine-presenting individuals. Since writing this paper, we've greatly expanded this work, primarily by deepening the channel of intent between the performer and the wearable system, which now includes a breath sensor that has adaptive thresholding. Breath was chosen as a trigger because it often serves as an impetus for choreographed motion, and it also offers some information about the emotional state of the performer. You can think of something as like a sigh, and it makes you feel some sort of way and also creates a certain kind of motion through the body. Our continued work also includes a participatory experience that allows audiences to activate a pair of wall-mounted wings with their own breath and motion. I'll end today with a quote from the conclusion of the paper. The imaginary world presented by the performer is, rather than a fully pre-programmed performance, a real-time navigation between human and robot around what it means to be a woman in an augmented perception of being inhuman. Thank you so much for listening in, and you can continue to follow our work at the URL thepeoplemovers.co/tpm-x-rad.